Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Greaves Cotton Limited's Q2 FY22 earnings conference call. From the management, we have with us Nagesh Bhasavanhali, Group CEO and MD, and Dalpat Jain, Group CFO. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Nagesh Bhasavanhali, Group CEO and MD of Greaves Cotton Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope everybody is doing well, staying safe. I welcome you all to the Greaves Cotton Q2 FY22 earnings call. Let me begin by giving you a little bit of an overview on the business, and Mr. Jain, our CFO, will take you through the financials. As some of you recall, we started on a diversification journey from a single customer, single fuel, single industry 4 years ago. Where are we today? Our diversification strategy has positively paid off. There is a consolidated revenue growth of 13%. Getting into the key highlights, new business continues to accelerate. New business now accounts for 40%+ contribution in terms of the overall business. As you may recall, in the last quarterly call, we had talked about the restructuring of the group into Greaves Engines, Greaves Electric Mobility, Greaves Retail, three primary business and two small enabler business. Let's talk about the three primary businesses. Greaves Electric Mobility records an 85% increase in volume, 111% revenue growth in Q2 FY22 versus the previous year. In terms of the Greaves Retail, Auto EV Mart, which is one of the earliest multi-brand EV players in the country, was launched this past quarter, and it's receiving very good inputs. Restructuring and consolidation efficiencies, which we've been working on for the last four quarters, are expected to result in an annualized fixed cost reduction, and Dalpat will talk about that. With new products, financing, and higher demand coming from growing network, Ampere, and Greaves Electric Mobility. In Greaves Electric Mobility today, we have Ampere, which is two-wheeler, e-rickshaw Elee brand, and we have the MLR. In the case of October, we are seeing good traction as well, in addition to the best ever quarter, the previous quarter. We've also invested more than 300 crores into the Greaves Electric Mobility business. We will continue to keep looking at forward-looking businesses and how to drive future growth. When we look at it in terms of three-wheelers, this past quarter, we have completed the acquisition of MLR Auto, which gives us access to L5 cargo and passenger three-wheeler, Elee e-rickshaw. With this, we have strengthened our position to become one of the largest players now catering to roughly 85% of the last mile mobility segment. We will continue to mobilize India, generate gainful employment for lower end of the pyramid, especially with our e-three-wheeler users, as well as contribute towards building the nation responsibly. Greaves Electric Mobility now accounts for 25% of the overall revenue. Auto engines or auto engine segment has had short-term challenges, post-COVID one and two, and that we are watching that segment very carefully for a recovery going forward. We are happy to also state that the other businesses, non-auto engines business as well as Greaves Retail businesses, have seen growth. In the past quarter, we have also launched a high-speed e-two-wheeler, Magnus Ampere, from the Ampere portfolio, which is the Magnus EX, with a 100-plus kilometer range, and which is a comfortable family scooter. With this extended range, and now Ampere being available in diverse segments, both in the B2B and B2C sides, we have a good coverage now. This, along with other ecosystem force multipliers, whether it is spares or service or financing, we believe this augurs well for the Greaves electric mobility. We had also talked about Ranipet factory, which is our mega site, and that's coming out well. And we believe it is slightly ahead of schedule, and we believe this will help us scale volumes and make Greaves electric mobility where we really need to go. Commercial production in this case will follow shortly. We've also talked about the Auto EV Mart and the strategy to electrify India and get into multi-brand retail. With this, let me hand it over to Mr. Dalpat Jain, our CFO, to go over the financials. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nagesh. Good afternoon, everyone. As Nagesh has described, the company is going through a transformation where we are seeing our core business having an impact on its revenue, but other businesses are fueling the growth. So in the quarter, we had a consolidated revenue of 374 crores, which is a 13% growth over last year's same quarter, and 63% growth compared to preceding quarter, that is Q1 of FY22. Out of the four business units that we have, the three, that was non-auto, the retail solutions, and e-mobility reported healthy growth year on year. E-mobility grew by 111%, retail solutions had a 27% growth, and non-auto had a 33% revenue growth. Auto engines continue to have the impact of surplus inventory, which was there at the OEM end, and the impact of post-COVID impact on shared mobility. So there we had a degrowth of 57%. Our focus on working capital and cash management helped in generating a 35 crore of free cash flow during the quarter. We ended the quarter with 265 crore of cash and cash equivalents. In terms of share of e-mobility, now it's almost 24 to 25% of the company's revenue, and its volume as well as revenue are growing month over month as we progress. The demand is quite high in this particular space. The restructuring exercise company had undertaken over last 3 years has started yielding results on the cost base. Compared to FY20's cost, the overall annualized fixed cost has reduced by 45 crores, and that is getting reflected in the P&L. So break-even point for the engine business has come down with that. Company's focus on the new businesses, particularly in the e-mobility space, will continue. The investments that we have made so far, as Nagesh mentioned, are 300 crores, and company is committed to further invest as we go forward. The couple of developments post-quarter end, company subscribed to 26% equity in MLR Auto, and with that we have got the presence in L5 segment, and company also completed the acquisition of remaining 26% stake in Bestway, which has presence in e-rickshaw under Ali brand. So with that, we have further strengthened our e-mobility portfolio. With this, I'll open the floor for questions, and both Nagesh and I will be happy to take up any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Ashutosh Tiwari from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. So firstly, on the electric mobility side, two-wheeler side, the volume is around 10,000 for the quarter. What would be share of the high speed? Because if I look at the Vahan data, the volumes are not much. So is the mix more tilted towards low speed in this quarter?
So Ashutosh, two factors. The Vahan data speaks about the retail sales. And in the quarter one, as we had seen because of COVID-led shutdown, the primary sale could not happen, and that led to a shortage of high speed at the secondary end. In the quarter, the high speed had almost 30% share of the total volume, and we are picking up further on the high speed production. So that share will increase as we move forward in the third and fourth quarter. So that these are the factors between the volume that we have in our presentation versus the Vahan data.
Okay. So incrementally, the share of this high speed will further increase from October and all. Is that correct assessment?
That's correct. So month on month, between July, August, September, this has increased. The average is 30% that I spoke about. And as we move forward, it is further increasing with the focus on the high-speed production. And localization, major part having completed now, our supply chain support partners are also getting stable.
Okay. And which parts are mainly facing issue in terms of shortage?
Those are chip-led parts. So particularly cluster, so some of the specific components, where there was a problem in the past quarter. Nagesh, you want to add?
So I think big picture, high speed is going to increase. I think the trend we are seeing month on month, like Dalpat said, October, where we've already recorded, I think it's in the deck, recorded over 5,000 plus sales. High speed is a much higher percentage than we have seen in the past. And localization, a lot of the hard work is done with our partners here. Supply chain remains a concern globally for a lot of the industry, not just us. And we are dealing with people, either the chips, the ECUs, basically a lot of the components that we can work with tier two, tier three. So we are doing what we can to look at the needs, not just for 1 month, but also for the next 12 months, and how do we manage that. So our supply chain teams are very active. We are definitely a very high percentage of localization, but some of our tier ones have supplies coming from outside and in some of this constrained environment, so we are managing that. That is one risk we are managing right now. But demand continues to be very high, both for high speed and low speed, and it's very evident with what we are seeing on the field.
So, Nagesh, you mentioned that in October and all that high speed version has gone up a lot. So, is it like now more than 40-50% of sales is coming from there, the volume basically?
Yeah, so it's early days. As you can imagine, it's not even, it's still 26. Yes, the trend is there. The good news is Magnus has been received very well. There is a wait list for Magnus. And now with the addition of Magnus EX, we have a longer wait list. So, the demand is much higher. And yes, high-speed demand is there, and it will continue to increase. I don't want to give a percentage right now, but in the next couple of days, once we close the month, we'll know. But yes, it is definitely increasing, and you should see that trend.
And lastly, before I join with you again, the losses in the electric mobility has widened. So one thing is that stake increase in this
option.
So, but even if you exclude that 7.7 crores, and first is that where is that recorded, that cost item? And even if you remove that, then also there is a loss of, say, 12, 13 crores. So, how do we look at the losses in this business going ahead?
Yeah. So, two factors in Q2 in terms of the e-mobility losses. One, the option value where the final transaction is completed now. The differential of the valuation has got accounted in the other expenses, and that's the impact of around 8.5 crore, including the expenses which are incurred related to that transaction.
Okay.
So that once we exclude that, there is a loss, and that loss is because of the investment which has gone in the people, the structure which to have the higher revenue, because quarter on quarter the traction is very high. And we have readied our infrastructure, the people and marketing expense to lead to that higher revenue growth. And the third factor is the price increases and impact on the RMC. So the gross margin have been lesser than what we had in the same quarter of the last year. So 2% impact has been because of this commodity price increase, which will neutralize as we go in the coming quarter.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashwin Agarwal from Akash Ganga Investments.
Hello.
Hi, Ashwin.
Yeah, sir, I just wanted to get a confirmation about the segmentation. Can you just give us the wide area of scope about the tier 1 volumes and tier 2, tier 3 volumes about the mobility?
Ashwin, we don't give the breakup, but we have given the segment level volumes in our investor presentation. What is the total two-wheeler volume, three-wheeler volume? So two-wheelers was at around 10,000 plus in the quarter. We have equally spread out network across India, and our distribution between tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 is fairly equi-split. So I would say between passenger and cargo, we have 55-40, but that is for three-wheeler, between 55-45. And rural versus urban is 70-30. So 70% of the revenue or sales is in the tier 2 and tier 3, 30% is in the tier 1.
Okay, thank you. And my second question is, like is our nearby competitor has been spending a lot of a cash burn to regenerate this type of this market growing on. So have we been planning for the any cash burn or raise of any debt fund?
So Ashwin, as you know, we have enough cash flow and a strong balance sheet. Whatever is required for the business, we are going to have the needful resources. But at the same time, Greaves has always been very focused on the right profitability and the cash flow. So we are not going to have cash burn for the sake of it. We are going to invest behind marketing people to have a long-term growth, but at the same time focusing on the profitability as early as possible.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vimal Goel from Union Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Dalpat, the first question is to you. If you just, I couldn't find out our regular disclosure on the segment revenue breakup. So if you could just help me, what would be the contribution from engines, aftermarket, e-mobility, and others?
Sure. It's there in our investor presentation, Vimal. But in the quarter, the e-mobility had a total revenue of 90 crores out of 374. Okay. The retail solutions had 88 crore of quarterly revenue, and balance was from the grease engines.
Okay. And aftermarket?
That's our retail solution, aftermarket plus GCGR. So that's retail solution, which was 88 crores in the quarter.
Okay. Engines you said was 90, right?
E-mobility 90. And balance out of 374 is the engines. So 180 between these two segments and remaining 190 crores in the engines.
Right. Okay. The second question is on the high-speed segment, you said that this quarter it was 30%. What was the number for Q1 FY21 and Q2 FY21 and Q1 FY22, last quarter and last year?
So Q2 FY22, as you know, the high speed was very low. I don't remember, but till H1 of last year, we were at close to 15-20% in high speed. Q4 last financial year, we were at 40%. Q1 this year was impacted by COVID. So from primary sale perspective, there was nothing. And that COVID impact also had impact on our supply chain, and that is where local supplier base got impacted with the one overall supply issues which are there led by the global chip issues. And that is where the share of high speed in quarter two was at 30%. But like Nagesh mentioned, with the increased focus on the high speed, we are seeing month-on-month growth and higher manufacturing of the high speed vehicles.
So basically, if I were to look at the trend, in first half of 21, you were at 15-20, you reached 40. For Q1, you were it was negligible. For Q2, it was at 30. And now you expect it to go to whatever, 50, whatever.
Yeah. And just to add to that, just for memory refresh sake, Q1, because of Coimbatore having a very bad COVID influx, our plants were down for 8 weeks. 8 out of the 12 weeks, we were down. right? So Q1 in that sense was an aberration. But yes, the overall trend that you touched upon is correct.
Okay. So if I were to look at the wholesale market share, okay, total market share, electric vehicles, if you could just give me some numbers on Q2 or, you know, H2 of FY22.
So Vimal, this is our the public data on Vahan, FADA and some of the internal data that we have. Our total share in Q2 was at around 15% in two-wheelers, including both high speed and slow speed.
15%?
Yes.
Got it. And okay. So it is pretty much in line with what you had done in FY21, the full year of FY21. So you have maintained your market share.
That's correct. In Q2, we are back to the similar level with both segments together.
Okay. Fair enough. And sir, last question was on Gentex. So this, Government of India's paper on, you know, reducing your, emissions because, due to your Gentex. So what is our recourse for this? How do we sort of get impacted because of this numbers? Because Gensets, I believe, is a good contributor and it has been growing well. What are our plans? So some of our larger competitors have announced that they will be looking at Gensets which are made for from renewable energy, etc. So what are our plans going forward?
Yeah. So about 4 years ago when we started the diversification, right, we said we will go to a fuel agnostic approach. Obviously, in auto engines, you're seeing that. In non-auto also, it will follow. And clearly, we are well aware. And like you're saying, I think we have seen a good uptick on genset sales, especially in the last couple of quarters with hospitals and this. And we will continue to evolve that technology. As we go forward, we clearly are committed. We are working on the CPC before. In fact, we will be ready ahead of time. And the technology and the fuel type also, we will continue to work, and we will deal with any regulations that may come up.
What you're saying is basically you'll be in line with your lower emissions. The technology that will come up will probably not be impacted. This particular business will not get as impacted going forward because of the...
We'll continue to keep investing in newer technologies like we have done on the auto side. That's the point, yeah.
Right. Sir, and if I could push in one more. Sir, in H1 of FY22, what was the capex that went into Ranipet?
So Ranipet total capex so far we have spent is around 8 crores of rupees.
Okay. This is the total capex in Ranipet.
The actual spend that I'm talking about.
Okay.
The actual cash.
And by the end of the year, how much do we expect to spend here?
Vimal, I'm not in a position to answer this right now. As you know, we don't give the forward guidance. Overall capex plan for the business, as we have told earlier also, total investment in the business, we are going to upwards of 700 crore. More than 300 crore we have already invested in the business so far.
Right, but that 700 crore was, anyways, that was 10 years, but yeah, anyways.
Over a period of 10 years, out of which 300 crores have got invested, and a lot of it will be front-ended as we had spoken earlier.
Fair. Thank you so much. All the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashutosh Tiwari from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead. Before that, I would like to remind participants to please limit your question to two per participants only.
Yeah, hi, sir. So on this non-auto engine volumes, I think there's a YOY. Is it the COVID impact or are you seeing that some stagnation is coming through in this segment? And how should we look at going ahead?
Two parts. Genset has seen a very healthy growth, and because of that overall pricing mix of the business, you would have seen the volume versus revenue growth is far higher in the non-auto. In the other segment, which is in the farm equipment and NAVE, there was a one-time impact last year because of the lockdown in the first quarter. There was a pent-up demand which led to a higher volume in the month of July and August. In the current year, though the lockdown was there, but at the same time, there were, as you know, the quarter one numbers were much better in the non-auto. So volume overall for non-auto, we should look at from the half-year perspective. And we expect the volumes to go up. Second issue was on the farm equipment, where some of the products were imported, and there has been ban on the import-linked product. So now we have tied up with the local manufacturer, and that volume will start from quarter three.
This is related to farm equipment, you said?
That's correct.
Okay, okay. No, I was referring to non-auto engines, which are used in infra and all. So there, the drop is not related to rural, right?
No, there the drop is related to the pent-up, as I mentioned, in the quarter one of last year, there was complete lockdown. So quarter two had a one-time impact. This year, that is spread out between quarter one and quarter two.
And secondly, on this electric three-wheeler side, probably we are doing 1,000 units per month right now. So which states you are seeing better traction, and how do you see this whole space over next, say, 2-3 years? How do you see the volume ramping up in this e-rickshaw segment? And also, you acquired this Teja brand for that L5 auto. So what is the plan over there, next 1-3 years period?
Sure. Ashutosh, I'll reply on the first part of your question about the traction. So it's the eastern and the northern states where we see the highest traction and the growth in the West Bengal, UP, Bihar. So that's the belt where e-rickshaws are very popular, and we are seeing a good growth coming in from those states. Primarily, the segment is catering to the guys who were having earlier hand rickshaws or the cycle rickshaws. They are now moving up towards e-rickshaws, and they are able, the person who was earning, let's say, 100 rupees a day, now with e-rickshaws, he's able to earn more than 300, 400 rupees. So that's a segment which is getting converted towards e-rickshaws. On the long-term part and the volumes, this is one of the segments which is having a highest penetration of e-rickshaws. I will let Nagesh talk about the vision and the strategy which we have towards e-rickshaw, as well as the L5, the Teja that we have acquired now.
So let me start with the e-rickshaw. E-rickshaw itself at the bottom of the pyramid, I think, is a great success story. I mean, there is obviously the unorganized players and the organized players. Amongst the organized players, we're one of the serious players in the top three or top four players, right? So, and that the market share continues to grow, right, in the e-rickshaw market. And we are seeing the monthly trend go in terms of 1,000 plus units of sales. That's being talked about, right? When you look at the monthly average from almost nothing, now we have grown like 3-4 times, right, in terms of where the monthly average run rates are, right? The volumes also have grown in terms of the roughly the 1,000 plus units that I was talking about, right? Where do we see the sales? It's obviously in the north, in the east, and a very strong focus in terms of lives and livelihoods. In fact, right after COVID too, also we saw a lot of traction. Financing is a key part in this, and I think with additional financing, this segment will continue to blossom. Longer term, to answer your other question, we see this market transition between lead acid to also lithium ion model, right? And some of the unorganized players moving away and the organized players getting a lot more traction. The expected CAGR will be good. We believe the CAGR in this segment, because it's again, lives and livelihoods, and at the end of the day, if you look at any of the analysis, right, third party analysis, the e-rickshaw park continues to grow. And I think we are well positioned in this. We saw this early, just like the two-wheeler. We saw this trend early, and we are, I think, in a good position to capture the growth there. Now, coming to the Teja or the three-wheeler, so this was part of our strategy, right? We started with two-wheeler, and then we moved to e-rickshaw. Now, the last piece was the e-three-wheeler, which is really the MLR brand, right? And we're just getting started. We just closed that a couple of days ago. So I think as we look forward into Q3 and Q4, you're going to see a lot more action there in terms of the e-three-wheeler, electric three-wheeler, as well as the traditional three-wheeler sales there as we go forward. Again, their financing will play a key, and building the dealerships will be the key. So some things that I think Greaves Cotton has done well, or Greaves Electric Mobility has done well. So we are quite confident when you look at both two-wheeler plus three-wheeler, that this addresses pretty much with our platforms now being available on two-wheeler, e-rickshaw, on three-wheeler, for both B2B and B2C application, it addresses a very wide market that's growing.
So will you use the same ELE network for this as well, Teja vehicles?
The simple answer is no. They have their exclusive e-rickshaw network, which is very, very strong in the north and the east. Some of the Greaves Care stores, through to Synergies, are selling that. But clearly, Greaves Retail and MLR will have their own network that we are leveraging the Greaves Retail for. So that's where some of the other synergies will come. So, but e-rickshaw and e-auto will probably be in two different channels.
Okay.
So, in summary, Greaves Electric Mobility will have the Ampere, which is the two-wheeler brand, e-rickshaw, which is the Ely brand, and then the e-auto will obviously be that MLR brand.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amin Pirani from JP Morgan. Please go ahead.
Yes. Hi, team. Thanks for the opportunity. My question was actually on the e-three-wheeler side, and, you know, pardon my ignorance if this has been asked before. You know, on the EV two-wheeler side, we have seen this evolution from, you know, lead acid to mainly lithium ion, and also now from mainly low speed, you know, to an increasing share of high speed. Within three-wheelers, again, you know, I think it started mainly as a lead acid thing, and, you know, the e-rickshaw is not really, I think, a comparable product to the auto rickshaw that we have. It is the e-auto, if I'm not mistaken. So can you give us a sense of, you know, within the electric three-wheeler industry, what is the broad share between lead acid and lithium, and also what is the share between the really small, slow-speed e-rickshaws and e-autos, and how is it trending?
So, Amin, hi, you are right in terms of the evolution. So in three-wheelers also, the segment has started with the lead acid technology, and today in the e-rickshaw we have 95% share of lead acid vehicles.
Okay.
And that trend is changing more and more. We are getting customers coming for lithium ion batteries as we go forward. So with the change, obviously there is a higher price difference between both, and that price difference is almost 20 to 25%, but we are seeing increasingly consumers are coming for the lithium ion batteries, and that share will go up as we move forward. Today in the two-wheelers, as you know, it's almost 50-50, and even in some cases 60-40, 60% in favor of lithium ion. So that journey will be taken in e-rickshaw also. Also, the auto is the right comparable, or e-auto is the right comparable product, and that is where our end to MLR. So with MLR, we are going to have presence in the e-auto segment also. Today it's a niche segment. In terms of penetration of electric vehicles, it's very small. I would say less than 5%, Nagesh, in terms of e-auto. So that penetration will increase with the products coming in from various OEMs, and MLR has the early entry over there with the ARI certified products. So hopefully we will be able to make increase the penetration out there with the lithium as a lead acid battery product.
Understood. And on the lithium and on the e-auto side, it is mostly the organized players who will be fighting it out, right? I mean, you are there. And I'm guessing, you know, we'll see entry from, say, the Bajajes and the TVSs. Whereas e-rickshaw will remain more of an unorganized segment, with you there, but mostly unorganized?
So, I mean, there are few players in the organized sector right now. We are the second largest and moving towards the largest in the e-rickshaw organized segment.
Okay.
The segment was 90% dominated by unorganized 3 years back. Today, unorganized share has come down to 62, and 38% is with the organized. As we move forward, we are expecting the share of organized increasing. And within that, with LE, we are bringing in new products with the better technologies to increase our share, which is in single digit today.
And if I can just add, in summary, if you look at what we've done, right? We started with the electric two-wheeler about 3+ years ago, right?
Yeah.
Before all the hype on electric two-wheelers started, because we were convinced that the shift was happening, disruption was happening, unit economics was going to get improved, right? Similarly, the e-rickshaw trend started early. So the two-wheeler trend, we were there early. E-rickshaw trend, we were there early, and we also hope on the e-auto, we are going to, right? So the idea is, whether it is lead acid or lithium, whether it is the sub-segments, the high-speed, low-speed on the two-wheeler, or the lead-acid versus lithium, our teams have caught the trends early. And I think that is helping us grow from almost a non-existing base or a very, very, very low base, right? And that's kind of how we see. And we are gaining valuable information in terms of customers, duty cycle, what works, what doesn't work. And glad to report that our products are getting very good traction from the customers, both B2C and B2B. So I think that probably gives you a little more picture.
Fair enough. That's very helpful. Thanks for that and all the best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amit.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashwant Rajan from ULJK Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Hello. I'm audible. Thank you for the opportunity.
Sorry to interrupt. May I please request you to speak a bit louder? The audio is not clearly audible.
Yeah, am I audible now?
This is better, so you can go ahead.
Yeah. Yes, I wanted to get some clarity on the current tax of 4.12 CR. As you can see, a loss of 18.98 CR. Can you shed some light on that?
Sorry, I could not hear the question clearly.
So I wanted to get some clarity on the current tax of 4.12 CR. As we can see a loss of 1.98 CR on the balance sheet. So could you shed some light on the current tax aspect?
So that's the advance tax, because as you know, the advance tax is paid basis the projected profit for the full year. So we have made the proportionate advance tax payment in June and September on the projected profit of the year, whereas the profit is going to be in the second half.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhishek from Sky Ridge Well. Please go ahead.
Yes. Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you for the opportunity. So my first question is regarding your higher other expenses. I know you spoke about this, but my line was not clear at the moment. So could you talk about it again, what led to the higher other expenses?
I'm sorry, there was an echo on your line at the last. We could not hear the question clearly.
No, I was asking you if you could talk a little about your higher other expenses. I know you spoke about it earlier, but I had some trouble with my line at that time.
So in the other expenses, there are two factors at consolidated level. One, there is a 8.5 crore of one-time expense due to value adjustment of 26% call option that we exercised for Bestway. Our wholly owned subsidiary, Greece Electric Mobility, exercised the option. So the difference between the originally considered value versus what is paid now, that has been routed through P&L. So that's 8.5 crore of one-time impact. The balance increase is due to the expansion of the people, marketing expense, and the infrastructure in e-mobility, which is geared for far higher revenue. And we are seeing quarter-on-quarter revenue growth, as is reported in quarter four to quarter two. So the people and the infrastructure is geared for much higher revenue, whereas cost is getting incurred at the earlier stage.
Okay, thank you, sir. So my second question is regarding your standalone EBITDA margin. So can we expect some improvement going forward, and are you able to pass on your cost increases to the customers?
Yes. So there are two factors which will lead. One, overall revenue. As we know, if you look at the last year's trend also, the third and fourth quarters have a better revenue because of season part, as well as we are seeing the post-COVID normalcy coming in, and that will have natural expansion. The second part, some of the initiatives which are taken up by the company to restructure businesses, consolidate auto and non-auto, is going to lead to almost 7-8% reduction in the fixed overheads, and that efficiency will kick in from the month of December onwards. So that's the second part which will help in expansion of margin. And third is raw material cost, where the commodity price increases have impacted the RMC. Now, with the vendors, the price settlement happens on a quarterly basis, whereas with the customers, particularly in OEM, we have yearly price settlement contracts. Some of those price settlement contracts have 1st of October and 1st of December as the restatement date. So these factors will help in margin improvement as we go in quarter three and quarter four.
Thank you, sir. That was very helpful. And sir, my last question is regarding your auto. segment. Sir, are we seeing auto coming back? Because I know we had struggled with auto volumes during Q1 and Q2.
So auto, definitely we are seeing the traction. So there were two factors. One, before the second wave of COVID in the March and April, we had seen the business getting normalized. So most of the OEMs had purchased and built their inventory. With the sudden lockdown, that inventory remained in the dealer channel and at the OEM's end. Post the lockdown opened, the first that inventory which was there in the channel, that got liquidated. And now OEMs have started demanding the from the suppliers like us on the engines front. So to that extent, there is going to be recovery as we go forward. And though the demand will not come back to what it was at the pre-COVID level with the overall impact on the diesel, but we expect volumes to come back at least to the last year's levels as we go forward.
Okay. Thank you, sir. All the best.
And one more part, to company actually envisages in 2017, and that is where it strategized to move towards e-mobility. Also, the plant consolidation and business restructuring had started. So though I spoke about quarter four additional reduction from the current levels, but as you would have noticed in the quarter two and quarter first half, already almost 12% cost has got reduced compared to what it was in 2003. So that plant consolidation, business restructuring at aggregate level, we will have a 16 to 17% reduction compared to FY20's cost level. And that will completely come in the next financial year's P&L versus FY20.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. That was helpful.
Yeah, just to add to that, in addition to the efficiency on restructuring what the CFO covered, keep in mind as part of this also is the diversification strategy. So one is the defense, another one is offense. Dalpat talked about the defense, which consolidation gave us a 16%+, right? On the offense, obviously auto engines, we expected diesel engine to go down. We invested in CNG and in electric. Then non-auto engines was a diversification. Now with the Greaves Electric Mobility and the Greaves Retail. So I think that's kind of where three out of the four businesses right now are continuing to show growth. And we hope on the auto engine side, things will pick up post Diwali.
Great, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pramod Amte from InCred Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for taking my question. First is, just wanted to know what is your current local sourcing and what type of imports and what you import, wanted to know about that. Second is, considering the fact that there are some challenges in sourcing from China with the recent shutdown, so are you going to face any challenges in the short term for ramping up to meet the demand on the production front?
Yeah, so first part of your question, in terms of localization, the initiatives that company took, we are in compliance with the FAME guidelines for the high-speed vehicles. So almost all the product, the supply chain is localized. Lithium cells, which are not there in India as of now, that continues to be imported, and the battery packs are done by the Indian suppliers. So that's to answer on your localization part, where high-speed vehicles are more or less now localized. Low speed, some component we continue to import. The second part, in terms of supply chain issues, yes, that's something which is continuing. We saw that in quarter two, the demand was far higher than the volumes that we have reported. It is the supply chain issues which impacted some of the production, and the demand could not be completely fulfilled. We are working with various supply partners, and we are confident that volumes will be able to increase from here on. And quarter three and quarter four, we are going to see a much higher volume compared to what we have seen in quarter two. But at the same time, supply chain related issues is one of the key monitorable in the e-mobility businesses for us.
But when you say the localization, even the FAME one says that about tier one or tier two, right? But there's a lot of components which come at tier three level still as imports. So when you look at overall as a system, does it still have a large proportion bearing on the including cells, the import content? Is that the fair understanding?
For high speed, I would say that other than lithium cell, there is no significant part which is as part of the imported component. Most of it is already localized.
Okay. And the other question is, you guys have been playing an active role in doing a domestic M&A and also consolidating the industry. Wanted to know, looking at the your product strategy for next 5 years, do you see a need to do any international acquisitions which can help you to strengthen your product portfolio or the sourcing strategies globally to take it to a next level?
It's difficult to answer, though, as you know, these are part and parcel of the expansion strategy that company continues to pursue. And with the management and board's consideration, we continue to look at all the options which are available. So company will do everything that is required in terms of its technology superiority, acquiring the right know-how. But difficult to comment. Right now, there is nothing which is at the where I can talk about the specific target.
Thanks and all the best.
The next question is from the line of Karthikeyan from Suyash Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much. I had a couple of questions, so bear with me. One is, can you talk about your experience in terms of FAME subsidies collection and what timelines are you looking at currently? Another question would be, can you also profile your current set of customers for the high-speed vehicles? You said a higher percentage is coming from Tier 2 and 3. Can you profile these customers?
Sure. Let me take the first question about the subsidy. So it's a cycle which is now well settled, where as a process, once the secondary sale happens, dealer submits the documents and within, so it's the entire cycle of 60 to 90 days within which the money comes to the manufacturer's account. So that's on the first part in terms of subsidy. Second part in terms of the customer profile, as I mentioned, 70% is in the Tier 2, Tier 3 towns. But at the same time, it is the millennial, and I would request Nagesh to add on to the consumer profile part.
Yeah, so I think we've been quite fortunate that we have two types of customers at the outset, B2B and B2C. B2B is our application-specific engineered products where we are providing vehicles to either rideshare carriers or cargo movers and stuff like that, right? On the B2C, we are seeing actually we had a very good day. Last week, we had 500 plus retails in one single day, right? Our Magnus EX has been very well received, which is the extended range 100 plus that was launched a week and a half ago, right? Our Magnus has had a wait list at our dealers right now, right? And the typical customer is anywhere between the young millennials, the Gen Z on one hand, right? On the other hand, we're also seeing office goers and people with family because our seats are wider, range is good, reliability is good, and we are seeing a lot of traction in that sector as well. So all in all, I think our looks design is good. So we are seeing a lot of traction on both the B2C and B2B. As we speak, that's kind of at a high level. And then when you look at website analytics, one in two user is below 34 years old. Top five states contribute to almost 73% of our traffic. We are seeing some very, very interesting dynamics because a lot of first-time buyers are coming in and buying this product. First time, I'm talking about first time to a two-wheeler. So we are bringing in a new set of audience to this, and that's what excites us. And the demand is far higher.
And what is the price sensitivity of the customer in your assessment?
Price sensitivity, keep in mind, over the years, and we have, I think this is very well demonstrated, our average ASP has gone up, right? From almost 40,000 rupees to now about almost 66 plus thousand rupees, right? So, and we also have a good range of products from the lower end, slow speed, to the higher end, right? And depending on that, of course, the customer segmentation is there.
Sorry to interject. I was asking you specifically on the high-speed vehicles.
On the high-speed, specifically with the subsidy and with the value addition, I think our vehicles are slightly higher priced compared to the immediate. So it is, we believe we have the right value proposition. And the demand far exceeding the supply is probably also indication of where the pricing is there.
And prices are expected to come down with the time, with the battery technologies changing and it's coming in India. So Indian consumer, as you know, is a value-conscious consumer. So our focus is always to provide the product at the right price point, and that's the USP on which Ampere continues to work.
The other thing is, keep in mind, Ampere or Reeves Electric Mobility plays in the heart of the market, the belly of the market, right? And so while post FAME II, in general, the industry may have seen prices going down, our sales have gone up, our ASP has gone up, right? Our value proposition has only improved. And I think you'll see more of this as we go forward.
Right. One last question. Kindly lend your perspective on this, which is I have heard a startup, I wouldn't say startup really, somewhat companies made some progress, retrofitting, you know, e-rickshaws with lithium-ion batteries. And these are, you know, do you see that as a threat to the organized players? Because in a certain sense, the large population becomes a ready target to convert. Your current impression about this particular thing?
I look at it slightly differently. This is an opportunity. The market size, when you look at two-wheeler, is about 20-something million pre-COVID. The market size for the three-wheeler is obviously another couple of million when you also add e-rickshaw, right? When I look at it at any point of time, now this is where our fundamental business model helps. While Ampere is interested, or Greaves Electric Mobility is interested in growing the new vehicle sales, Greaves Retail, which does servicing, multi-brand service, multi-brand spares, multi-brand retail, is also from time to time looking at retrofit also as an option, because we are already talking. Are we doing that today to a big extent? We are not, because it's also a commercially viable proposition. But that's something that we have been exploring for a while. And if the right opportunity and the right technology comes in, we see ourselves through our Greaves retail outlets, right, going after that. It again gets back to the right value proposition, right? Is the right value proposition there for the customer to pay that X, 1,000 rupees or whatever it is? And will that, is there an ROI for that? That's why today the market is still struggling on that. In fact, we have been watching this segment very closely. And if it takes off from a commercialization, you will see a participation on retail, Greaves retail. But I don't see, no, to answer your question, I don't see the market size is so big. Greaves Electric Mobility demand should not be impacted with this.
Sure. Thanks for answering my question, and very best wishes.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Vimal Goyal from Union Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, so sir, in the last conference call, you indicated that currently Coimbatore has a capacity for about 5,000 units per month. And if I were to sort of annualize, I mean, if I were to look at the quarterly numbers, we have, and this is only for two-wheelers, yeah? So for the quarter, we have done about 10,000. So if I were to assume that, you know, you had the capacity, available capacity of 15,000 and you've operated at 10,000, so would this purely be because of shortage, or what could be the reason for, you know, sort of operating at slightly lower capacity utilization?
Yeah, Vimal, you are right. It was primarily because of the supply chain issues, where shortage of one part or the other impacted the overall production.
Yeah. Thanks, yeah. Dalpat. Dalpat, just following up on the previous question that I asked on the breakup of your revenues, I think till the earlier quarter, you used to also give out a segment which was others, which included the revenue from genset, agri pumps, etc. So if you could just give me the breakup in the first half of, from engines and others, is that possible?
I will maybe talk to you on that, because right now our three main pillars of the business, how we have restructured, is Greaves Engines, which includes all the engines as well as the other equipment associated with the engines. And Greaves Retail is mainly from aftermarket and Greaves Care, Greaves Retail.
Fair enough, fair enough. Thanks a lot. I'll come back in the queue. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jagannathan, individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, you are.
Yeah. Good afternoon, Mr. Nagesh. Congrats on launching the Magnus EX. Happens also to be the best price to features scooter, EV scooter. I just wanted to get a sense on the production capacity for the EX in particular and for other EV bikes. I mean, both high speed as well as the ones that you cater to on lead acid. And when do you think you're going to fill the pending demand for EX as well as the Magnus Pro? As you mentioned, there's a huge pending demand. So I would like to know when you fill the pending demand and what is the backlog? Like, what is the number that is likely that is required to be filled? The second part of the question is, what is the total production capacities for the e-rickshaws that you have? And I needed to get a sense on the total number of e-rickshaws that you produce. And the last question would be with regard to what is the outlook for the engine business going forward and margins for the next quarter? And with regard to the financial partner you were talking about in an interview, is there any thought process in Greaves to get a financial partner or a technical partner for the EV business? Thank you.
Thank you very much, first of all, for recognizing the Magnus EX. Yes, we are very excited with the response we're getting, right? In terms of, I'll take a couple of questions and then Dalpat will jump in as well. In terms of the technology, in terms of the partner, I'm assuming, are you talking about the fundraise for the EV business? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, the fundraise, or if you need a technical partner to, you know, to put a brand by your side to sell even more. But I'm assuming that since you're selling whatever you produce, you don't need a partner right away. But yeah, it could be a financial partner or a technology partner.
Yeah, so I think, like I've said publicly, I think we are open. And if the right, we believe we have an exciting business case, an exciting model. If the right partner comes along and we, it makes sense, yes, I think we'd be open is what I've said. Now, coming to this, capacity is not an issue. Going back to what we were saying earlier, right? Between Coimbatore and now Ranipet beginning to ramp up very quickly, and we'll be ready by, we are slightly ahead of schedule, we'll be ready by the end of the year, right? And in addition to that, e-rickshaw, to answer your question, I think also has the capacity. Our biggest challenge, like Dalpat was alluding earlier, is the supply chain, right? We have actively pursued localization, we have local suppliers, we are working with them, we are working with tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 vendors to secure our quantities for not just for one quarter, but over the next four quarters. We are doing everything we can. So if supply chain is an, not a constraint, I think we'll the numbers should, case in point being, last quarter was the best ever quarter for Greaves Electric Mobility. October seems to be the best ever month. Until 25th, we have not even finished the month, right? So capacity is not an issue. The commitment from the group is not an issue. Are we in the right place between two-wheeler, e-rickshaw, three-wheeler? I think the answer is yes. Supply chain is the only thing I don't control, and we are working very, very hard on that. We have moved some of our best people from Greaves side also into Ampere to help us with supply chain, and you will see the numbers hopefully improve as the supply chain improves. I think I've covered everything. Dalpat, have I missed?
Yeah, afternoon, Nagesh, you've covered all the questions. Yeah, what is the total pending demand? What is the outstanding demand for Magnus? Because, see, when we go to the dealers and check with the dealers, the normal statement is, we have yet to deliver what we booked 3 months back. Or, I mean, there are different kinds of, there's different kind of feedback. So, if there is a, or some people converting from Magnus to Magnus EX, Pro to Magnus EX, because they say, okay, anyway, Magnus EX is getting delivered, so we would probably do Magnus EX rather than Magnus Pro. So, but the point I'm trying, the question I'm trying to ask is,
I got it.
What is
that? I got the question, sir. I got the question. Yeah. So, it's about roughly about 8 weeks plus of demand. And we are obviously working as fast and as furious as we can to fulfill the demand. But the good thing is, we are delivering. We are working very hard every day. You can see the products on the ground. Our products have been around. It's proven, tested. Our products are delivering and exceeding people's expectations. Some of the product reviews I've seen, right? So, and I think we will overcome this shortage as well. But it's a good problem to have. We are working very hard to meet the customer demand.
Right. Thank you. So because I've booked one for myself, so I thought, okay, maybe
oh,
since I went to the deal. So since I went to the dealer and I was talking to him, and so this is also a dealer feedback. So yeah, but otherwise everybody seems to be happy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Nagesh Basavanhali for closing comments. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all for a very energetic and a very passionate discussion. In summary, as we announced, I think our diversification effort, our consolidation, our restructuring efforts are paving way both in terms of the offense and the defense that I touched upon, right? With four acquisitions done in the last 4 years, I think it puts us in a 85% of the two-wheeler, three-wheeler category in the Greaves electric mobility. Our Greaves engines, especially on the non-auto side, is showing definite increased traction. Our Greaves retail on the spares is showing traction. In fact, when you look at the numbers, you can see Greaves retail as well as Greaves non-auto engines and Greaves electric mobility all tracking to ahead of Q3 of last year or in that range. Obviously, we are watching the auto engines demand very carefully, and we will see how that evolves from a market standpoint. But all the things within our control, whether it is offense or defense, I think we remain committed to executing that. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for your time. Thank you. Happy Diwali, everybody.
Wish you all a very happy Diwali. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
On behalf of Greaves Cotton Limited, we conclude. We thank you all once again. Stay safe. Please conclude this investor call. Thank you for joining us.